BJP's master plan for 2019 elections decoded. The BJP UP IT cell announces that it will now raise an army of what they call Cyber Sena, tasked to reach as many people as possible online and win elections for the party.
Ahead of the 2019 Lok Sabha elections, the UP Bharatiya Janata Party is hoping to get in at least 2 lakh social media experts as part of its cyber warrior. And these cyber warriors, or the Cyber Sena as the UP BJP calls it, will be responsible for handling the social media, which according to the UP BJP IT cell is going to be very, very important in this upcoming elections.
The party proposes customized strategy for every citizen. A similar strategy was unleashed in Karnataka and Mirror now expose their modus operandi. Social networking being used in a hope to influence voters.
In fact, we are the only party, Bharatiya Janata Party, went on to, you know, to track the behavioral aspects of, you know, on the social media.
We have around 36,000 WhatsApp group across Karnataka, and we have 56,000 booths in Karnataka. Out of that, almost 95% of booths, they are active and they are connected with our call center and control room.
As the election war shifts from ground to the world of social media, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram and WhatsApp, Mirror now asks, can social media be misused by our netas? Should the Election Commission monitor social media before elections? Let's debate.
Here with the Urban Debate on Mirror now, Fede Souza. Thank you for joining us or staying with us. 2 lakh cyber yodhas who will form a cyber army in Uttar Pradesh in preparation for the 2019 elections. What will these people do? An average of 35,000 rupees a month. What kind of money are we talking about, really? That will be their salaries, and where will this money come from? But first, the question that we're asking is simply this. Will elections from now on be fought entirely on social media? Is it important right now for the Election Commission to perhaps look at a code of conduct for social media? Should other such problems be looked at more carefully? We're not saying right now that a cyber sena is right or wrong, because there's no regulation, there is no law preventing the amassing of a cyber sena, or basically a really, really large team of cyber professionals to look into this. We're asking what this means for elections in the future. Joining me on the show, Rakesh Tripathi, spokesperson of the BJP, Brijesh Kalappa for the Congress, Dilip Cherian is a PR guru and a brand expert, Ritesh Bhatia is our cybersecurity expert, Naman Pugalia is the co-founder of Fourth Lion, an analytics and technology company, Shailesh Gandhi, former Chief Information Commissioner, T.S. Krishnamurthy is the former Chief Election Commissioner. I welcome all of you to this conversation. Thank you for joining us. I'm going to start with Ritesh Bhatia. Ritesh Bhatia, my question is this. Wouldn't you like to see a 2 lakh member social media team?
I would love to see that. 2 lakhs. And, you know, as you rightly said, at a salary, an average salary of 25,000 rupees per month, and we're talking about 12 months, you know, for the entire elections, it will take a year or so, and preparing them and other kind of things. So we're talking about 6,000 crore rupees. That is number one. Number two is, what about the consent? Now, their job is to, what I read, what I understand is their job is to, you know, send us messages telling us, okay, what all achievements they have done or they plan to do and other kind of thing. So there's going to be a tsunami of messages. And there's no doubt about it that there's going to be a lot of fake messages too. So dealing with those also is going to be like really a tough task. But 2 lakhs is really an astounding number.
Let me also ask Mr. Shailesh Gandhi. Mr. Gandhi, one of the things we noticed, of course, during the UP and the Karnataka elections, UP, Gujarat, Karnataka, was that social media was being used extensively by both parties, by the BJP and the Congress, although the Congress took some time to catch up to what was going on. Do you think perhaps it's time for the Election Commission to look at regulations of what is being, of the messaging on social media as well, or is that a monster that simply cannot be controlled?
I think a serious attempt must be made by the election. This cannot be stopped. Nobody's going to be able to stop it. So to say we don't want this, we don't like this, is a useless exercise. But the point you're making about how to tackle this, how to ensure that misuse doesn't occur, how to ensure that fake news doesn't travel too much, these are things that are part of regulation. And I think a team of people, it'd be very foolish of me individually or to three, four of us on this panel to say this is how we should regulate, but certainly there is a need for regulation. And I'm sure if enough heads are put together in the next couple of years, we will be able to see a sensible regulation developing, which will ensure that we are not trying to fight progress, but are ensuring that it's regulated.
Well, Rakesh Tripathi, mujhe aapse ye puchna hai. Rakesh Tripathi is with the BJP. अभी रितेश भाटिया ने एक छोटी सी कैलकुलेशन की. He basically says that every social media professional is paid about 25,000 rupees a month. This would mean, this would amount to a little over, you said, what,
6,000 crore
rupees. Is this true per year? Is this what the BJP will be spending on its cyber sena?
एक्चुअली मैं महसूस करता हूं कि राजनीतिक दल को देखने का, समझने का नजरिया अभी शायद बहुत बदलने की जरूरत है, समझने की जरूरत है. भारतीय जनता पार्टी में पेड वर्कर काम नहीं करते हैं. भारतीय जनता पार्टी के कार्यकर्ता विचार के आधार पर, संपर्क के आधार पर, नीतियों के आधार पर, नेताओं के साथ संपर्क संवाद के आधार पर पार्टी के साथ जुड़ते हैं और अपना लगा करके पार्टी के साथ काम करते हैं. तो मैं एक बात बिल्कुल क्लियर कर दूं कि इसमें किसी भी तरह से किसी को पेमेंट के आधार पर रखा जाने वाला है, ऐसा नहीं है. बहुत सारे ऐसे पार्टी के कार्यकर्ता जो अलग अलग स्थानों पर काम कर रहे हैं या पार्टी के साथ नहीं जुड़े हैं लेकिन सोशल मीडिया पर एक्टिव हैं, उनको पार्टी के साथ जोड़ना और उसके जोड़ने के कारण है. हम मानते हैं कि इसमें एक तो पार्टी का विस्तार होता है, पार्टी के साथ जोड़ सकते हैं हम ऐसे बहुत सारे यूथ को जो पॉलिटिक्स से इतर हैं लेकिन सोशल मीडिया पर अपनी राय रखते हैं, अपना ओपिनियन रखते हैं, उनको हम पार्टी के साथ कनेक्ट करते हैं तो हमारी पार्टी का विस्तार होता है. एक दूसरी बात, पार्टी के जो कार्यक्रम हैं उन कार्यक्रमों को हम सोशल मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म का उपयोग करके जनता तक पहुंचा पाएंगे, ये एक दूसरा इसका मोटिव है. और तीसरा, हम केंद्र सरकार और राज्य सरकार दोनों जगहों पर हम सरकार में हैं, इन दोनों ही जगहों की सरकारों की योजनाएं जनता तक पहुंचाने के लिए ये साइबर जो हमारी जो टीम होगी, जो आईटी टीम है, ये बहुत अपने आप में इफेक्टिव रोल प्ले कर सकती है. और हमने देखा है कि इससे पहले 2014 के चुनाव में जब हमने इस पर एफर्ट किए थे तो उसके शानदार परिणाम आए हैं. अलग अलग राज्यों के चुनाव में हमारी आईटी सेल की टीम ने बहुत अच्छा काम किया है, सोशल मीडिया ने बहुत अच्छा काम किया है. और सोशल मीडिया की इंपॉर्टेंस को कोई अब नेग्लेक्ट नहीं कर सकता है, वो इतना इफेक्टिव मीडियम है.
जब आप कहते हैं कि आपके सोशल मीडिया टीम बहुत अच्छा काम करता है, क्या आप हमें समझा सकते हैं त्रिपाठी जी, क्या आप हमें समझा सकते हैं कि आपकी सोशल मीडिया टीम क्या काम करती है, स्पेसिफिकली उनके क्या मतलब जिम्मेदारियां होती है, वो क्या काम करते हैं?
देखिए, मैं दो तीन तरीके, मैंने अभी तीन काम आपको बताए. भारतीय जनता पार्टी ने पहली बार, भारत की किसी भी राजनीतिक दल में पहली बार हमने ऑनलाइन मेंबरशिप शुरू की है. भारतीय जनता पार्टी ने मिस्ड कॉल करके मेंबर बनाना शुरू किया, उसको ऑनलाइन तरीके से हमने उनको विजिट भी किया है. ऑनलाइन मेंबरशिप हमने की जिसके कारण पार्टी का विस्तार हुआ है. हमारी जो आईटी टीम है वो इसमें काम करती है. आईटी टीम की मदद के कारण ही हम आज, और जो वर्चुअल वर्ल्ड में बहुत सारे लोग हैं जो भारतीय जनता पार्टी के विचारों से प्रेरित हैं लेकिन उनके साथ सीधा संपर्क करना, संवाद करना कई बार कठिन होता रहा है, तो वो अब हम इस मीडियम के माध्यम से, सोशल मीडिया के माध्यम से वो पार्टी के साथ जुड़ते हैं, पार्टी की नीतियों रीतियों के बारे में जानते हैं. दूसरा, पार्टी के जो कार्यक्रम है इन कार्यक्रम को मैन टू मैन पहुंचाना एक कठिन काम रहा करता था. हम सोशल मीडिया पर एक ही बार में कोई मैसेज टॉप टू बॉटम बहुत इजीली आसानी से पहुंचा लेते हैं. उसमें बीजेपी की आईटी टीम जो है, आईटी मीडिया टीम है, उसको मैसेज को स्प्रेड करने में, सर्कुलेट करने में बहुत अच्छे ढंग से परफॉर्म कर पाती है. किसी भी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी के लिए ये एक एसेट के रूप में होता है. तीसरा, हम केंद्र और राज्य दोनों जगह पर सरकारों में हैं. सरकार की बहुत सारी ऐसी योजनाएं हैं जो हम सोशल मीडिया के प्लेटफॉर्म पर जब उसको शेयर करते हैं तो वो आम जनता तक बहुत आसानी से रीच हो पाती है. बहुत सारी ऐसी योजनाएं हैं जिनका जनता तक प्रसार नहीं हो पाता है, जब हम सोशल मीडिया के प्लेटफॉर्म पर इन सारी चीजों को लेकर के आते हैं तो जनता उससे लाभान्वित होती है. और साथ ही साथ बहुत सारे ऐसे दुष्प्रचार हैं जो विपक्षी दलों के द्वारा फैलाए जा रहे होते हैं, ऐसे में उनका भी हम जवाब सोशल मीडिया के आधार पर दे सकते हैं, जनता तक हम सत्य पहुंचा सकते हैं.
Right, and this is basically the head of the IT cell UP BJP, Sanjay Rai, who has said that cyber warriors will approach every citizen with a new strategy, ensuring that information pertaining to various schemes, policies and achievements of the center arrive or are delivered to each person. Why is this making you smile?
I'm wondering, when he said that these are the like karyakartas and this thing, is he referring to those unemployed youths? Because you know we've been just struggling over people not having jobs and other kind of things. So so these 2 lakh people who are not going to get paid, according to him,
yes.
will they leave everything? So we have so many kind of people who are going to leave that kind of thing and just come and work over there?
That's a good question. Rakesh Tripathi, आपका कहना है कि 2 लाख लोग अपने मतलब रोजी रोटी वाला काम छोड़ के फ्री में बीजेपी आईटी सेल के लिए काम करने वाले अगले एक साल के लिए?
मैंने फिर कहूंगा कि राजनीति के संदर्भ में अपनी समझ का विस्तार करें. पार्टी किसी भी पार्टी का कार्यकर्ता कोई फुल टाइम वर्कर नहीं होता है. फुल टाइम वर्कर बहुत सीमित संख्या में होते हैं. जो मैं एडवोकेट हूं, प्रोफेशनली एडवोकेट हूं और वकालत का काम करता हूं, लेकिन पार्टी के प्रवक्ता के तौर पर अपनी भूमिका का निर्वहन करता हूं और इसके बदले में कोई पैसे नहीं लेता हूं. इसीलिए आज सबके हाथ में स्मार्टफोन है. पार्टी के कार्यकर्ता स्मार्टफोन के आधार पर, अपने लैपटॉप के आधार पर, जहां भी इंटरनेट कनेक्शन की अवेलेबिलिटी है उसके आधार पर वो पार्टी के विस्तार का कार्य करें. उसके लिए घंटे, दो घंटे, आधे घंटे का समय लगाएंगे. इसके लिए कोई बेरोजगार लोगों को हम जोड़ने का काम कर रहे हैं या उनका रोजगार छीनने का काम कर रहे हैं, ऐसा बिल्कुल नहीं है. ये पार्टी के साथ जो विचार के आधार पर, नीतियों के आधार पर जुड़ते हैं, जो चाहते हैं कि भारत.
ठीक है, फेयर इनफ. नमन बुगालिया, माय क्वेश्चन इज दिस 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 पॉइंट अबाउट डिजाइनिंग मैसेजेस फॉर एवरी सिटीजन, विल दिस इन्वॉल्व सोशल मीडिया प्रोफाइलिंग?
यस, एब्सोल्युटली. आई थिंक व्हेन वी लुक एट सोशल मीडिया देयर आर 3 एस्पेक्ट्स दैट वी मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड, दीस 3 वेक्टर्स. वन इज आइडेंटिटी ऑफ द पेजेस, द हैंडल्स, द नंबर्स दैट आर डिसेमिनेटिंग द इंफॉर्मेशन. Is that identity that of an actual individual behind the handle, or is this a bot? The second vector to be understood is authenticity. Is this information factual, or is this manufactured or doctored in some way? The third vector we must understand is relevance. The content that is being disseminated, is that somewhat relevant to the people to whom it's targeted, or is it something that the party must...
So basically what this means is, what you're saying is that they will look through the social media profiles of people online and then profile them based on what they believe and push stories to them.
Depends on what they're doing. If they are campaigning, which is simply the dissemination of information, they don't get into that kind of harvesting. If they are canvassing, which is the act of GOTV or get out the vote, which happens closer to polling day, that's when they seek a golden triple. A golden triple in our vocab, when we campaign, is essentially 3 parameters that come together. The contact information of an individual that may be on social media or maybe a postal address or maybe a phone number. The second is the voter ID, which tells us where does this individual vote, and therefore if that's the booth, what are likely to be her or his concerns. And the third is leaning.
Yes.
Is this voter aligned towards a particular party? As a worker, I think about whether they are red, which is they're aligned to my opposition. They're yellow, which is they're somewhere in the middle, or they're green, which is which means they're my supporter. On the basis of these 3 key parameters, I decide how to go about canvassing as far as this individual and his or her family is concerned.
All right, let's open this up right now. I'm opening this to this entire panel. We've heard what Mr. Tripathi from the BJP had to say. And I want to, at this point, bring in Mr. T.S. Krishnamurthy, former Chief Election Commissioner. Mr. Krishnamurthy, thank you for joining us. Do you believe that the Election Commission should now look at social media and look at these social media cyber senas and bring in new updated regulations for how messaging is sent out?
First of all, I would like to tell you that I've been waiting for 15 minutes and I was told the subject is going to be on the banks, control of public sector banks, and you're asking me a question about Election Commission. Be that as it may, I would like to tell you that Election Commission has a responsibility to regulate the cyberspace, and I'm sure that the Election Commission is addressing this problem, and day by day, the cyberspace irregularities and deficiencies are increasing. So we need to update our regulations, and I am sure that the Election Commission is addressing this issue.
Mr. Krishnamurthy, first of all, please allow me to apologize to you on behalf of my team. There was obviously a mix-up in the topics that was given to you. What we're talking about here is the fact that there is a massive cyber sena that is being put together. Now, while we have a code of conduct on messaging that political parties can do on the ground, social media doesn't have a code of conduct as of now. There are still instances that when an election is going on and the code of conduct has brought into place, the political parties will be cutting ribbons and inaugurating roads and doing other things in other parts of the state or country, knowing that the messaging flows across social media anyway. Now, do you think that perhaps we need to update the code of conduct?
No, in course of time, actually the model code of conduct has become a mockery in this country. And that's why I have always been saying that we must give some legislative teeth to some of these provisions of model code of conduct. So, for example, you can, through the social media, through the television, you can contact the voters of a particular constituency, even though the model code of conduct is in force in particular constituency. It has become a joke, and I don't see any reason why we should have this kind of a toothless model code of conduct where we cannot enforce anything on the political parties. And the political parties are the law unto themselves. They are not willing to be regulated on their own, and they don't wish to be regulated by the Election Commission either. This is the way the state of affairs is there. So I feel that some stronger hand is required to ensure that the regulations are tightened up and to ensure that the model code of conduct has got some teeth, legislative teeth, so that you can disqualify a person, you can penalize a person, either a candidate or a voter. Only then some improvement can take place.
Mr. Dilip Sharian, do you find this 2 lakh member team, slightly scary, because we're talking about only UP here. This is one state. We're not talking about the entire country. Only in Uttar Pradesh, there'll be a 2 lakh member team of people who will manage social media. Have you ever heard of anything like this?
I think that the figures are just astounding. And there are three things I'd like to say about this social media team itself. One, it's clearly a Trojan horse. It's something meant to divert our attention from something more serious that's going on. I don't know what it is. Secondly, saying that they are all going to be volunteers is a great cop-out, because the fact is that, you know, they can say almost anything and the party will be able to say, these are just volunteers. They're not on our paid sena, so yes, there's nothing we can do about it. As far as what Mr. Krishnamurthy said, you know, the fact is that, as other panelists have also mentioned, the fact is we are going to be at the receiving end of a tsunami of both cyber hustling and cyber hyper-efficient cyber armies, which are going to drown us and drown all the other sounds. Given that there are 150 young voters who are going to be voting for the first time in the general elections 2019, we really are talking about a very sensitive public. Keep in mind also that what Cambridge Analytica threw is that there are cynical and competent people who can actually give you all the data mining that was being talked about a little while ago. So with a large army, with access to the right kind of in-depth information, you're talking of serious capability of mind-bending people who are voting for the first time or perhaps the second time. So that's a majority of voters you're talking about. So that's very dangerous. But the most dangerous thing is what we have forgotten, that besides the fact that no party will take responsibility for these kinds of people, imagine the kind of danger that could happen if a Russia interfering in the US elections kind of scenario were to happen, and God forbid if the ISI were to get their hands into hacking a few hundred of these troll army members and putting out all kinds of incendiary information. So we are really talking of very dangerous stuff that could get disseminated when you have lots of unprotected accounts, unprotected equipment, and anybody saying whatever they want, unregulated totally.
Mr. Chetty, you said troll army for cyber sena. Is there a reason why you believe this army will be used fundamentally to troll people? And who do you think is going to be at the receiving end of this trolling?
You know, as someone who has handled digital media for multiple parties, and we work with across a range of parties, the fact is that there are two ways to disseminate your information. One is to make sure that whatever you say gets multiplied manifold and gets pushed onto a whole bunch of unsuspecting people who are not at the receiving end of your messages otherwise. But the second equally efficient way is that when somebody does something positive, to have jokes, cartoons, all kinds of things mocking it, to proliferate at a rate where anything good that is being said by any party can be rubbished by the opposition, either by a mixture of invective or by good humor or by just plugging it as fake news. So there's a whole range of techniques that campaigns use to drown out good news by a party, because the opposition's method of winning is to drown out the good news and expand their own good news.
Rajesh Kalapa, is your army ready within the Congress party?
See, traditionally the Indian National Congress had not believed in the effectiveness of social media. And this was our state in 2014, but we have made considerable headway. Now by 2018, we have a whole bunch of volunteers across the country, we've spanned out across the country. And today we are effectively dealing with the several issues which the BJP has been throwing at us on a regular basis. And we've been dealing with them most effectively. So this transformation from 2014 till 2018 was visible with the fact that Mr. Amit Shah, who I think has made most effective use of social media, conceded during the Gujarat elections that, look, we are losing the war of social media. So ultimately, what does it all boil down to? Since he's mentioned that, and he also exhorted his workers not to believe every messaging which comes through. So effectively, what we were doing is that, there were these cyber armies and troll armies, which Sadhvi Khosla has spoken about, which Chaturvedi has spoken about, and a whole lot of people have spoken about. Now, effectively, what has happened is that a lot of impetus has been placed in regard to, one, bringing out what is true and what is fake. And these fake accounts, fake messaging have all been called out. And this is, I think, in a big way, I think it has helped us, because it has been found out by the neutral person who realizes that, look, this kind of fake imagery, messaging,
it all emanates from one political party alone. Same question for both of you, Brijesh Kalapa and Rakesh Tripathi. You said you have volunteers now who will be your cyber sena. How will you control these volunteers and what they say? Because they're not hired by you. They can say whatever they want. So if someone from your camp is trolling somebody on Twitter or Facebook, how will you control them?
You see, first of all, as everybody knows, we are quite cash-strapped, and the Indian National Congress doesn't have the kind of resources that the BJP has. And we don't have, you see, it's very simple.
That's not the answer
that you can ask any general person that he's on several WhatsApp groups. You can ask any average person which kind of messaging does he see on a WhatsApp group. What kind of messaging does he see on a WhatsApp group? You must remember that there are three kinds of social media accounts. One is Facebook, Twitter, and the other is WhatsApp.
No, you're not answering my question.
And if one has to read WhatsApp,
how will you control trolls from your camp?
It has to be written by professionals.
How will you control trolls?
And if only professionals, professionals will come to you only if they are paid. And today, if you see the kind of messaging that a political party sends out, these are clearly paid professionals. So that alone will tell you that, these are the people who are paid.
So let's ask this question. One second. Let me ask the same question to Rakesh Tripathi. Rakesh Tripathi ji, मुझे आपसे ये पूछना है, ये 2 लाख जन आपके जो साइबर सेना में काम करने वाले हैं, क्या इनमें से अगर किसी ने सोशल मीडिया पे किसी को गाली दी, किसी को एक बुरी तरीके से बात की, क्या आप लोग उन पे कुछ एक्शन लेंगे? क्या आप कंट्रोल कर पाएंगे ये 2 लाख जन को?
देखिए फिर मैं एक बात कहूं, कोई भी पक्ष है उसका सकारात्मक पक्ष और नकारात्मक पक्ष दोनों ही होते हैं. किसी भी व्यक्ति के नकारात्मक पक्ष हो सकते हैं, लेकिन उसके संदर्भ में भारतीय कानून व्यवस्थाओं के तहत तमाम सारे अलग अलग कानून बने हुए हैं. आईटी एक्ट है, अगर किसी ने भी अगर कोई नॉर्म्स तोड़े हैं, कोई ऐसी बात कही है जिससे अश्लीलता प्रसारित होती हो या किसी की मर्यादा का हनन होता हो या किसी के संदर्भ में अगर वो किसी तरह का विद्रूपण करते हो तो निश्चित तौर पर उनके विरुद्ध विधिसम्मत कार्रवाई होनी चाहिए। और उसमें कोई भारतीय जनता पार्टी का कार्यकर्ता करे तो उसके विरुद्ध नहीं होगी, ऐसा नहीं है। जो भी कानून तोड़ेगा उसके विरुद्ध कानूनी कार्रवाई होगी।
और वो
साइबर लॉ में तमाम सारी ऐसी व्यवस्थाएं हैं अलग अलग तरह की। अब
एक तो पहले बात तो साइबर लॉ में ऐसी कोई व्यवस्था है ही नहीं, और दूसरी बात आपका ये कहना है कि ये 2 लाख में से किसी ने अगर किसी को गाली दी तो हमें जाके कंप्लेंट फाइल करनी पड़ेगी, लेकिन आप अपने 2 लाख जन पे कुछ एक्शन नहीं लेंगे।
मैं एक बात बहुत जिम्मेदारी के साथ कहूं, भारतीय जनता पार्टी के कार्यकर्ता अनुशासित कार्यकर्ता है, भारतीय जनता पार्टी के कार्यकर्ता विचारों के आधार पर जुड़ते कार्यकर्ता है, और फिर भी अगर किसी कार्यकर्ता ने कहीं कोई गलती की है तो पार्टी रेक्टिफाई करेगी, उसको पार्टी से बाहर करेगी अपनी। हम ये IT टीम से जोड़ रहे हैं पार्टी के साथ, ये 2 करोड़ हमने जो मेंबर उत्तर प्रदेश में जोड़े हैं अपने, उन्हीं 2 करोड़ मेंबर्स में से ही ऐसे होने वाले हैं जिनको हम जो साइबर के बारे में जानकारी रखते हैं, जिनको सोशल मीडिया की समझ है, जो इंटरनेट के साथ यूजर फ्रेंडली है, उनको साथ में जोड़ने के लिए काम करेंगे और वो मैसेज को स्प्रेड करने का काम करेंगे। फिर भी अगर कहीं कोई कमी होगी तो निश्चित तौर पर उसमें सुधार करेंगे।
ओके, ब्रजेश कालापास रिस्पोंडिंग। ब्रजेश गो अहेड।
या फिर आई वाज ओनली पॉइंटिंग आउट दैट माय लर्नड फ्रेंड फ्रॉम द बीजेपी has been speaking about using these powers responsibly. I may only humbly point out, and I think every single panelist will agree with me, that the honorable prime minister of India follows people who have been making explicit comments regarding women. 1, 2, they've been making threats. 3, they've been rejoicing at certain people's deaths. So this is the honorable prime minister of India who's doing that. So I hope, with my learned friend from the BJP will understand the seriousness of what we are speaking about.
Okay, let me open this up to this entire panel at this point. Dilip Cherian, serious. Dilip Cherian, are you convinced with the answer that we've received from both parties?
The fact is that Brijesh Kalapat seems to be on the defensive. I have no idea what his plans are, but be that as it may, they are woefully inadequate is already obvious. The fact is that this is not about money. This is all about technique, this is all about speed, and this is all about commitment. And as our friend from Uttar Pradesh is saying, they have a bunch of people whose commitment is good enough for them to unleash them on the public of UP and perhaps beyond the borders of UP. The fact is that it is impossible to control them, and he himself is saying that there are laws in the land. All of us know that the laws in the land are hopelessly incapable of saving anybody. And there is also the fact that much of it does not even apply to what happens in WhatsApp, because by definition, under the law, WhatsApp is a one-to-one communication. So you're really talking about a toothless law, you're talking about an inadequate force to police this, and you're talking about an election commission which doesn't have, honestly, today, the foggiest notion of what it's got to tackle even. Forget the capability of tackling it. It doesn't even know the scale of the problem that we are talking about. So leaders may mouth whatever wonderful statements they want to make about commitments, about being on the straight and narrow, etc. But, and whatever the excuse, lack of funds, whatever it is, the fact is that calling this out on a day-to-day basis is an immense task. It will require, more than bots and perhaps a really advanced form of artificial intelligence to be able to spot and destroy on dissemination. Difficult task.
Indeed, a difficult task. We have a couple of people on the phone line. Jaydeep from Bangalore, go ahead, Jaydeep.
Hello.
Yes, Jaydeep, go ahead.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Go ahead, please.
Okay. First, let me congratulate you for your Mahul, that toxic Mumbai cell exposure.
Thank you.
I'm very thankful that you have effectively exposed that particular story.
Thank you.
Now, coming back to this point, this particular conversation, what you are having, I am focusing on a different angle.
Okay.
It is solely about the money that is involved, which naturally the parties will say that we don't have any people being paid. But the ultimate point, this has got a link with your previous debate, where Mehul Choksi, Nirav Modi, or is it Vijay Mallya? when they leave the country. Today I am telling you on record, just go and inquire 3 years before they left and 3 months after they left. What is the amount being donated in the political party fund? I am not naming any ruling party or opposition party. It is the fund created from these type of industrialists who has looted Mother India for 70 years. And they can get a passage. Imagine Vijay Mallya leaving Mumbai immigration with 19 bags. And the CCTV camera is showing the picture to the ministry, respective ministry. And they gave a green signal and he left the country. And their donation money is flowing over to
So to be fair, Jaideep, we don't have any evidence for that. And I don't allow anybody to make statements that cannot be backed by evidence on national television. So I'm going to make you stop there. SP Marwa on the phone line from Panchkula. Go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, Mr. Marwa.
Can you hear me,
please? Yes, we can. Go ahead, please.
I have a message for all political parties across the board.
Yes.
There is a misconception among most of them, in fact, all of them, that people of the country are fools. And they will be able to make a fool of them by doing this carpet bombing of social media. People of India are very wise. They know what is being done on the ground.
Yes.
Are we able to give education to the people? Are we there to give employment to the people? If the political parties do that, they will get re-elected. Right. Not by just promising and trying to brainwash people that we will give them moon.
Yes. Okay, so that's a very, 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 very well said, that people of India are not stupid and you can't brainwash us with lies. But Shailesh Gandhi, I want to ask you the first question that came in, and that's the question of political funding. Is there a problem in political funding right now that we don't know where the money is coming from, even though both parties have said these will be volunteers? But organizing volunteers also requires funds, Shailesh Gandhi.
This is very unfortunate. Without saying so, almost all political parties are accepting that they will operate on money which is in black. And they will give it various names and try and fool all of us. I think we should all recognize that the amount of funding is not going to go down. It's going to keep increasing. And based on 6,000 crores that was estimated for UP, I would say it would mean 2 to 3 lakh crores if all parties start spending on money across the nation. And that is not the money that is being spent on elections. Far more is being spent. In fact, in a way, I'd be happy if it's spent on educating the voters on what they feel is right or good, rather than spending it on liquor and saris and cookers. I think this is a better position. Where will it lead us? I think what we will demand and what we must demand is transparency of funding, not just funding, transparency in the election process, transparency in political parties. The law requires them to be transparent. The law has said that they are subject to right to information, but like completely illegal set of people, they've all said we won't listen to the law. They've not challenged this in court, and they are saying we just don't care. 6 major political parties of India, and you have got political representatives, please ask them what is their excuse for defying the Central Information Commission's ruling and not even challenging it legally. They're just saying, we won't do it, end of story, and we are so powerful, you can't touch us, which is true. Please ask them, are they talking of this or are they just wanting to mouth platitudes and keep fooling us as one of your telephone viewers said? This is what they are doing, and we are allowing them to do it. Let's question them carefully and say, please tell us, why are you not transparent? We want an answer to that. Why are you not following the law? You want to be a lawmaker, but you don't want to follow the law. How can this work?
That's an excellent question. In fact, Mr. T.S. Krishnamurthy, is there a big glaring question on political funding at this point? The fact that no political party wants to be transparent about where their money is coming from?
Well, as far as funding of the political parties is concerned, the changes that have been brought about recently in terms of cash donations and the electoral bonds, they have actually taken away the transparency aspect and have promoted more obnoxious nexus between the corporates and the political parties. I can tell you one thing. In the last few years, I have been associated with the electoral law and practices of various countries. I think all the reforms that have taken place in this country have come only through the Supreme Court and not through the government. The government, neither of the political parties, or rather all political parties, are guilty of ignoring electoral reforms every time that they are in power and every time they are in opposition. No party even mentions about electoral reforms in their manifestos. And if this is the chaotic situation in which we are going to allow political parties to function without no regulation, because there is no law regulating political parties, and with the first-past-post system you have, this country is probably going to is not going to improve the quality of democracy. On the other hand, we are going to destroy the cause of democracy in this country. Unless and until serious issues of electoral reforms are addressed quickly, I have very grave doubts about the quality of democracy in this country in the years to come.
Very well said. I have a question for Dilip Cherian. Dilip Cherian, if I were to ask you today, as a client, to put together a team of 2 lakh volunteers who are not being paid, but to get them to work as a team for the next 12 months at least, what would that cost?
It would cost a figure of, I think, the figure that was mentioned earlier, upwards of 6,000 crores. And there are two dangers to this. One is that an army of this kind cannot actually be managed at all. It's almost impossible to find anybody who can manage a team of 6,000 people working towards one mission, even if they have very clearly been trained and enunciated in what they have to do. The second thing is what we have to, if you look at the bigger point of this debate, the fact is that when armies of any size, of any kind, of this kind of vitriolic nature are unleashed, what you're really going to have is, as Mr. Krishnamurthy just said, a descending quality of democracy. What you're going to do is you're going to reduce all of elections into a meh-meh-tutu kind of situation where people are just screaming invective and innuendo at each other, mixed with all kinds of fake news and libelous stuff which cannot be traced back to people because there'll be anonymous handles. And to manage this kind of an unruly, motley crew, and by the way, you cannot find this number of people who are trained in cyber communications of any kind. Forget their grammar and forget the quality of facts that they will be able to marshal. So it is an impossible task. Even if you were to give me this as a client of mine, I would say these numbers are very unrealistic, and maybe you can build up to some realistic number of, say, 10 or 20,000 by the time elections come. But this figure of committed warriors, of e-warriors, is just an impossible number, and it's just a pipe dream.
Rakesh Tripathi, simple question, Mr. Tripathi. Aapke jo 2 lakh volunteer honge, unke basic qualification kya hogi is kaam ke liye?
भारतीय जनता पार्टी के साथ उनका जुड़ाव हो, लगाव हो, वो पार्टी की रीति नीतियों के साथ जुड़े, पार्टी के कार्यक्रमों को समझें, ये सबसे पहली क्वालिफिकेशन होगी। मैं मानता हूं कि इसके संदर्भ में किसी एजुकेशनल क्वालिफिकेशन की कोई जरूरत नहीं है। अगर आप सोशल मीडिया की समझ रखते हैं, आप इंटरनेट फ्रेंडली हैं, आप स्मार्टफोन इस्तेमाल करते हैं और आप अपने व्यूज को लिख सकते हैं, स्प्रेड कर सकते हैं, सरकार की योजनाओं के बारे में आगे बढ़ा सकते हैं, तो ये आप पार्टी के कार्यकर्ता हो सकते हैं। मैं बार बार निवेदन करूं कि जो एक्सपर्ट के तौर पर बैठे हुए लोग हैं यहाँ पर, वो शायद भारतीय राजनीति की समझ एक अलग अंदाज में रख रहे हैं, वो मार्केट के हिसाब से समझ रहे हैं। भारतीय राजनीति में कार्यकर्ता पेड वर्कर नहीं होते हैं, इसलिए आप इसको बार बार जो एनालिसिस इस आधार पर लेकर के जा रहे हैं कि इसका खर्च कितना होगा और कितना पैसा इसमें इन्वॉल्व होगा, तो मैं बार बार निवेदन कर रहा हूं, पार्टी के कार्यकर्ता वॉलंटियर के तौर पर काम करते हैं।
मिस्टर त्रिपाठी, 2 लाख जन वॉलंटियर के काम पे कर लेंगे, लेकिन 2 लाख जनों को ऑर्गेनाइज करने के लिए, उनको सिखाने के लिए आप ट्रेनिंग कैंप तो रखेंगे। आपके आईटी हेड ने बोला है कि 3 महीने में ट्रेनिंग कैंप रखी जाएगी, उनको ट्रेन की जाएगी। आप ही ने कहा कि आईटी एक्ट है हमारे देश में, आईटी एक्ट तो सिखानी पड़ेगी आपको इन लोगों को। ये सब करने के लिए पैसे तो लगेंगे, कितने पैसे लगेंगे और कहां से आ रहे हैं पैसे? शैलेश गांधी का ये पूछना है कि पैसे कहां से आएंगे।
मैं निवेदन करूं, अगर आप पार्टी की किसी भी कार्यविधि को समझेंगे तो किसी भी पार्टी के जिले पे संगठन के कार्यालय होते हैं और वो जनता के सहयोग के आधार पर ही चलते हैं। जिले की जैसे बैठकें होती हैं वैसे ही जिले की आईटी टीम की बैठकें होंगी, जिले की आईटी और होती रही हैं, अब तक होती रही हैं। हमने 2 करोड़ मेंबरशिप इसी उत्तर प्रदेश में की है और आज हमने उत्तर प्रदेश में 147,000 बूथ हैं, 147,000 बूथों पर 20-20 लोगों की कमेटियां हमने 120,000 बूथों पर बना करके रखी हैं, जो सामान्य कार्यकर्ता हमारे साथ काम कर रहे हैं, हम उनके साथ भी मीटिंग करते हैं, उनके साथ भी प्रशिक्षण करते हैं, उनके भी वर्कशॉप्स लगाते हैं। तो ऐसे ही एक आईटी सेल के रूप में हमारे जो स्पेसिफिक काम करने के लिए हम उनको बिल्कुल ट्रेन करने में किसी प्रकार की कोई समस्या नहीं है। इसमें किसी प्रकार का कोई खर्च होगा, मैं इसकी कल्पना से भी मुझे अजीब सा लग रहा है कि
ये सब फ्री में कंप्लीट कर रहे हैं, तो आप ये सब फ्री में होगा, मतलब जब आप ये सारे 2 लाख जनों को ट्रेनिंग देंगे तब आप चाय भी नहीं पिलाएंगे उनको, सब फुल फ्री में हो जाएगा सारा काम?
नहीं नहीं, देखिए मैं मानता हूं कि चाय के खर्च अगर जोड़ेंगे आप, हाँ? तो किसी भी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी के अपने खर्च होते हैं, वो ऑडिट भी होता है उसका।
नहीं नहीं, तो आप बताइए ना, शैलेश गांधी का पूछना है कि आपके पैसे आते कहां से आप लोग। हां शैलेश गांधी आप पूछ लीजिए।
आप इतना बताई दीजिए सर, आरटीआई में आप अपने
आर्थिक जनता के सहयोग से सर के चंदे से चलती है
सर। सर मेरी एक, अच्छा ठीक है भाई साहब, बहुत बढ़िया है, ये आपको एक सिंपल सवाल पूछ रहा हूँ। कानूनी तौर पे आपको आरटीआई में आना चाहिए, आप नहीं आ रहे हैं, क्यों नहीं आ रहे हैं? या कहिए कि आप आएंगे 1 महीने 2 महीने बाद, इसका कोई ना कोई आप कारण दीजिएगा कि कानून को क्यों आप फ्लाउट कर रहे हैं, कानून की ध्वजियां क्यों उड़ा रहे हैं। आपको सरकार के बनके आपको कानून बनाना है हमारे लिए, तो आप कानून का क्यों नहीं अमल कर रहे हैं, इतना बता दीजिए।
देखिए मैं बहुत निवेदन के साथ कहूं कि राइट टू इन्फॉर्मेशन केवल गवर्नमेंट अथॉरिटीज या गवर्नमेंट के साथ जुड़े हुए शासकीय संस्थाओं पर ही लागू होता है, किसी निजी संस्था पर या किसी निजी व्यक्ति पर लागू नहीं होता है। राजनीतिक दल कोई सरकारी संस्थाएं नहीं होती है,
कानूनी तौर पे लागू होता है, आप पूछिए किसी
के बीच में काम करती हैं, इसलिए
अब आप खुद ही कानून बनाएंगे?
नहीं बिल्कुल नहीं,
आप खुद ही कानून
सरकारी कोई सरकारी संस्था
ये है, सेंट्रल इंफॉर्मेशन कमीशन ने कहा है कि आपको
नहीं। देखिए अगर 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 व्यापक तौर पर
ये आपने खुद का
नहीं, देखिए व्यापक तौर पर पॉलिटिकल कंसेंस बनेगी अगर राजनीतिक सहमति बनती है, सभी राजनीतिक पार्टियां विमर्श करती हैं और सभी राजनीतिक पार्टियां एक साथ सहमत होती हैं कि वो आरटीआई एक्ट के दायरे में आती हैं, तो भारतीय जनता पार्टी पीछे हटने वाली नहीं है। हम हमेशा इस बात के पक्षधर हैं कि व्यवस्थाओं को कैसे ज्यादा पारदर्शी किया जा सके, जनता के बीच में लाया जा सके, और हमने ही इलेक्शन के लिए जो रिफॉर्म्स की बात है उसको लेकर के आगे बढ़े हैं। ₹2,000 तक का जो चुनावी चंदा हुआ करता था हमने उसको चेक से 2,000 से ऊपर के कोई भी
शैलेश गांधी, वी हैव टू आल्सो आस्क दिस क्वेश्चन टू ब्रिजेश कलापा एज वेल, व्हाई वोंट यू ओपन योरसेल्फ अप टू आरटीआई, व्हाई वोंट यू अलाउ अस ब्रिजेश कलापा फ्रॉम विद इन द कांग्रेस पार्टी टू नो वेयर योर मनी इज कमिंग फ्रॉम?
नो आई थिंक सी द एज फार एज फंडिंग इज कंसर्न्ड, फे everybody knows where the funding comes from and our funds are audited, income tax applies to
same
us
answer.
And everything. So if this were the case, if the only reason, 1 minute, the only reason why Mr. Shailesh Gandhi says that political parties must come within the ambit of RTI is because prime land has been given to us, but prime land has been given to several newspaper companies, media houses. Where's the difficulty in everybody coming under RTI? You can't have a choice of saying that only so and so and so and so, but not so and so. Then anybody who's taken, government land at concessional rate, let's all come in. Let the media houses come. Let the newspaper offices come. Let's all join RTI. We have no difficulty. But it's not right for one organ which has taken government lands, which has made use of concessional rates from government lands, to say to another organization that, look, you come under RTI, but we don't come under RTI.
Everybody should come under RTI. Right? I don't see any reason why not. Shailesh Gandhi, quickly respond to that, and I want to move on from this point. Shailesh Gandhi, go ahead. You got answers from both political parties. Go ahead.
Mr. Kalappa, there is a decision. Mr. Kalappa, there is a decision by the Central Information Commission, which is a statutory body set up in the law. You are not doing as per its order, nor are you even challenging it in court. What you are doing is acting, I'm sorry, but completely with complete disdain for the law, and that's what you are doing, that's what BJP is doing, that's what the Communist Party and various other parties are doing. Please give us an answer. Do you recognize that the Central Information Commission has said you are under the law? Do you recognize that you are not following the law? Do you recognize that you've not challenged the statutory authority? Please tell us this much. That's all.
All right. I want a response now from Mr. Krishnamurthy. Mr. Krishnamurthy, you heard the response of both political parties on the entire funding issue and coming under RTI. Are you convinced with the answers they're giving? They're both saying there's enough regulation, everything is transparent, we're being audited, that should be enough. Is that enough, Mr. Krishnamurthy?
I entirely agree with the Central Information Commission. The political parties are public authorities and they should come under the purview of the Central Information Act and they should provide information except the political strategy part of it. The political strategy need not be disclosed to the public, but all financial matters, the internal working, internal democracy in the party, everything should be available for public scrutiny. I support the order of the Central Information Commission in this regard, and the political parties should have a responsibility to the people of this country to explain what they are doing. As I said, except the political strategy relating to elections, all others should become transparent and available to the public of India.
Yes. Ratin on the phone line from Mumbai. Ratin, go ahead.
Yeah, hi, Faye.
Hi.
I just want to say you're doing a commendable job.
Thank you.
Night I tune into your channel.
Thank you.
You're one of the leading journalists in our country now. I just want to say one thing to Mr. Tripathi. You've got 2 lakh in UP joining the Cyber Sena. I'll say bring in 10 lakh, bring in 50 lakh. The 130 crore Indians, you can't change our mind. You can't brainwash us. If the product is faulty, 2 lakh, 10 lakh, 50 lakh will not change. Your product is faulty. The product was sitting on a stone today and doing some kind of arson.
Right.
We know what that is. That's on the Prime Minister of the country.
Okay. Ravi Gupta from Coimbatore. Ravi Gupta, go ahead.
I want to know from Tripathi ji, have they lost that Mudra Sabka Saath Sabka Vikas with collecting 2 lakh workers? And if they spend minimum 100 rupees per worker for a one-time food, it comes to 2 crore rupees. So per day, how many black money will they release?
Where is the 2 crore rupees coming from?
Black money from India.
Where is the, so I think that, you know, we're circling back to the same thing. Where is the money coming from? Where is the money coming from? I have one last question to ask off the panel. Dilip Charian, 2 lakh people, 2 lakh, let's call them soldiers, who are going to be communicating with the general population. Who are they going to be messaging? Where did they get those phone numbers from? Now, if there are 2 lakh karyakartas sending out messages, there has to be a huge database of phone numbers exactly to be sending messages to. Where would that database come from, Dilip Charian?
You know, the point is not just about the database, Faye. The fact is that all these people are going to be consuming vast quantities of data. So some data plan also has to be funded, unless some telecom companies are also volunteers and are willing to give their data plans also for free. So the fact is that there is a huge amount of money that's needed just to make sure that these 2 lakh volunteers, wherever they're operating from, let's assume they're operating from their own homes or from their own handhelds, there's a variety of expenses that will be involved in just the dissemination of the information, besides, of course, the research to get to their targets. So there are going to be companies who are going to be doing deep data mining using, you know, all kinds of technology and bots to make sure that they can access these people and give them list of targets. So in communications, we as a company know that your communications design is one element of it. Then there is the idea of who to target it to. And the third part is measuring what's the impact of the communications that you've given to them so that you can modify your communication in the next round to make sure that it gets the effect that it's meant to get. So being able to managerially tackle what 2 lakh people in one state of the country are going to be doing is going to require a huge backbone of technology and managers, of very senior managers who understand this technology, who understand the feedback loop to make this effective. Otherwise, it'll be just a whole bunch of, you know, pot shots in the dark. And the danger is that these pot shots in the dark could also be a very large quantity of information which could
choke up our airwaves. You know, there was a joke on Google some time ago that India's good mornings, bhajans and flowers in the morning are actually choking up the internet. So can you imagine what these yodas would do to your and my internet access?
That's an excellent question. Let me take that question to Rakesh Tripathi. Tripathi ji, aapke 2 lakh karyakarta ki data plan aur recharge kaun dega paise?
देखिए, मैंने पहले भी कहा कि कार्यकर्ता अपने घरों पर रह करके अपने संसाधनों से पार्टी का कार्य करते हैं। मैंने अपना स्वयं का उदाहरण दिया कि मैं एक प्रैक्टिसिंग एडवोकेट हूं, भारतीय जनता पार्टी के प्रवक्ता के तौर पर काम करता हूं और इसके बदले में किसी प्रकार की कोई पेमेंट नहीं लेता हूं। मैं इसको बार बार कह रहा हूं, भारतीय राजनीति के कॉन्सेप्ट को समझ ही नहीं पा रहे हैं। अरे, ये किसी कार्यकर्ता का कोई मोबाइल रिचार्ज नहीं कराने वाले हैं। कार्यकर्ता अपने मोबाइल से, अपने प्रेरणा से पार्टी की रीति नीति को आगे बढ़ाने का काम करने वाला है। ये मार्केट प्लान नहीं है, मार्केट स्ट्रेटजी नहीं है। पार्टी के कार्यकर्ता जैसे काम करते हैं वैसे ही आईटी सेल के कार्यकर्ता अपनी विशिष्टताओं के साथ काम करेंगे पार्टी के लिए। इसमें कहीं भी पैसे का कोई प्रश्न नहीं है।
If we keep the money part aside, you know, fine, okay, they will do it their way and all, even the transparency of the funding and all. But the thing is, where do these messages come from? Mr. Tripathi is saying that these guys will make the messages on their own and send. No, it has been clearly proven time and again, you know, we have seen it on your show also, that there is a larger IT cell, and the larger IT cell sends these messages to these this entire army, which sends it forward. Yes. Second thing is, you know, like the gentleman said, that, you know, people are wise enough not to get influenced. I don't completely agree with him, because the people in the rural area and all, they really get it. In an urban area, you know, like 10 lies make it a truth.
Well, okay. Yes, I have to wrap this up right now because we've completely run out of time. But the number of lynching cases that we have seen happen all in urban or semi-urban India, starting from Bangalore to other parts of the country, where basically WhatsApp messages have pointed at kidnappers and people have been lynched to death. Even today there was a case. That proves that we are gullible as far as social media is concerned. So several big questions have gone unanswered. If there are 2 lakh people in one state who are going to form an army, will that cost any money? Are they being paid anything at all? Even if they're not being paid salaries and they're doing this completely out of the goodness of their hearts, will they be paid money for their data costs, for their recharge on their phones? Will they be paid for chai, pani, nashta, any of this? And where will that money come from? Organizing a large team is very challenging. And like Dilip Cherian pointed out, if you organize a large team of volunteers and you're not going to pay them at all, including data or chai, then where is the accountability of what that team will do? Will you be able to take somebody to task if the person begins trolling someone? If the person begins sending out hard messages? If the person begins breaking the rules? What will we have to deal with when political parties start setting up social media armies? And of course, like was rightly pointed out by our representative who was former election commissioner, Mr. Krishnamurthy, he said that the Election Commission's model code of conduct is completely outdated at this point and has zero teeth when it comes to elections as they are held today. It needs to be updated to take into accountability social media and things like this. 2 lakh member armies put together, the Election Commission must update its regulations. It is all that it does promise us is that the next 1 year is going to be extremely interesting. Stay informed and stay smart. Thanks for watching. We'll be right back.